Welcome back, geology fans. There have been many attempts over human history to give an age to this Earth and explain how it came to be. Bishop Usher used the Bible as an historical document and took it literally to say that the Earth was created in 4004 BC. Guess what? The current evidence does not support this. But before you get your bonnet in a twist, realize there was no evidence ultimately for Halley and Jolie's idea of salt concentration in the ocean saying the Earth was around 90 million years old, or the idea of Lord Kelvin that the Earth could not be more than 100 million years old. As more evidence came to light, we began to realize that geologic time was deep, deep time. We see from a modern representation of the geologic time scale that we currently think the Earth is 4.56 billion years old, that the Precambrian ended and the Paleozoic began around 541 million years ago, and the Paleozoic era ended and the Mesozoic began 254 million years ago, and the Mesozoic era ended with the extinction of the non-avian dinosaurs 65.5 million years ago. So, clearly, modern geologists disagree with all those previous attempts at dating the Earth, and today we will find out why we geologists advocate for such an ancient planet. Why is it that the great Lord Kelvin said the Earth could not be older than 100 million years old? He was an expert in thermodynamics, the first and greatest, and all respect to him for that, but he was dead wrong on the age of the Earth. He calculated the amount of time it would take for the Earth to start from a molten liquid state and cool to the present-day Earth with an average surface temperature of 15 degrees Celsius. His answer was that such a planet would cool within 100 million years, and thus could not be older than that. What he missed was radioactive decay of heavy isotopes that would add energy to the interior of the Earth. It turns out that radioactive decay does exist, and we know how the fission, that is the breaking apart of these heavy isotopes, releases heat, and so the Earth can be older, even much older than 100 million years, from a thermodynamic point of view. Not only does radioactive decay open the temporal door to the possibility of billions of years, it also provides a clock by which to measure the absolute ages of certain materials and say whether they are millions or billions of years old. An atom can spontaneously break apart and convert some mass to energy and change to a new element, meaning a different number of protons in the resultant atom's nucleus. This is the uranium to lead series showing the two main flavors of radioactive decay. Alpha decay releases a helium nucleus made of two protons and two neutrons. The elements of the periodic table are solely determined by the number of protons in the nucleus, and thus an alpha decay transforms an atom by dropping it down two positions on the periodic table. Uranium-238 drops down two spaces to become thorium. And because it lost two protons and two neutrons, we drop from uranium-238 to thorium-234. We call the original element the parent, and the resultant element the daughter product. Uranium-238 is the parent and thorium-234 is the daughter in this alpha decay example. But the daughter, thorium-234, is also radioactively unstable and will decay itself, and thus be a parent for a new daughter product. However, thorium-234 does not decay by the 2-proton-2-neutron alpha decay, but the other major decay process we are concerned with. This is beta decay, and involves a neutron releasing an electron and an antineutrino. We can ignore the chargeless and almost massless antineutrino and focus on that negatively charged electron. If we take in an electrically neutral neutron, and we take away a -1 electron, we end up with a +1 nuclear particle. In other words, we turn the neutron into a proton. In this case, we step up one space on the periodic table. But as antineutrinos and electrons have negligible mass, the mass doesn't really change. So the new parent, thorium-234, will decay up to protactinium-234 through beta decay. In turn, protactinium-234 will beta decay back up to uranium, but not the previous uranium-238, as we have uranium-234 as the daughter in this particular case. As it turns out, there are a series of radioactively unstable isotope daughters along this chain that proceeds from uranium-234, which alpha decays to thorium-230, which alpha decays to radium-226, another alpha to radon-222, a noble gas there, and another alpha to polonium-218. From there, we can go a number of pathways via alpha and or beta decay, but in general, we end up with stable lead of some flavor, and so this whole chain of reactions is called the uranium-lead series. The thing is, though, if we take a single parent atom, say uranium-238, we can never say exactly when that one atom is going to decay spontaneously to its daughter. This is within the weird randomness of quantum mechanics, making the prediction for a single atom impossible. However, if we take a population of these atoms, we can talk about the average rate at which these spontaneous reactions occur within the population. The analogy in my head, which dates me pretty badly, are pachinko machines. These pinball-like games that shoot a single metal ball to the top of the machine and the ball then cascades down between the pegs in a manner that is nearly impossible to predict. And at least impossible to predict a single ball's path, as it is impossible to tell when a single atom will decay. But what if I dumped a population of metal balls at the top of the machine? Statistically speaking, there will be a non-random pattern of how a population will work its way down through the pegs. I could possibly take a picture of the balls moving down the pegs and be able to tell exactly how long it has been since the balls were all dropped at the top of the machine. And so it is with a population of radioactive isotopes. Here's another analogy. If I take a single M&M in a box and shake it up, I really have no way to tell when I open the lid whether the M side will be facing up or face down. It's impossible to predict this 50-50 outcome except by just guessing. But let's say I take 100 M&Ms and put them all with the printed side up. Printed side up represents the parent state of our changing system in this analogy, and if the printed side flips downward, then it's turned to a daughter. Now, shake the box, and we can say something predictable about the population of M&Ms. It should turn out that about half of the candies should have flipped over. This is an experiment in graphing you can do with your kids. Let them eat all those candies that turned over and count up the number left. Plot it on a graph over the number of times you shake the box, and then do it all again. You started with 100 all facing up, and then close to 50% flip over. Close the box with the approximately 50% parent and shake it again, and now around half of that half of the original 100 will have flipped. Eat candy. Count candy. Repeat. It's unlikely with just 100 M&Ms that you will get a perfect 50% at every shake, but if you did this experiment many times, that is the value that would be approached. In the end, you will get a graph that looks like this, which is also called an exponential decay curve. Our single M&M run would more closely match the predicted line if we use 1,000 or 10,000 M&Ms. Fortunately for us, a typical mineral or rock that we wish to date doesn't just have hundreds or even thousands of one type of radioactive isotope. It usually has trillions and more than one type of radioactive element, as we saw with our uranium-lead series. Another difference between real radiometric dating and our candy experiment is that each time we shake our M&M box, we are making an analogy to a concept we call the half-life. In our candy box, we could vary the time between when we shake the box, but in radiometric dating, the time it takes for a half a population of parent to turn to daughter is, according to both experimentation and theoretical bases, a constant period of time. In that fact lies the radiometric clock. One formulation would be as follows, where n sub t is the number of parent atoms remaining in the sample at time t, which is usually now, and n sub 0 is the original population of parent when the sample formed. E is the natural number, the crankshaft of mathematics, around which we crank the rate of parent conversion by taking the natural number to the power of the negative value of the decay constant times the time passed. As both the decay constant and time are positive values, the natural number is always taken to a negative exponent, forcing it between a resultant value of 1 to 0. But the same formula can be expressed as follows, where capital T is the average lifetime of one of these parent atoms, and this can be rewritten as where T one half is that half-life, the set amount of time between shakes of our box, the amount of time it takes however many parent atoms you have at a given time to flip over to daughter atoms. And isn't it nice that not all radioactive isotopes have the same half-life? In fact, they all differ, and in such a wide range of times that each has its best range of use, allowing us to pick and choose the best isotopes to hone in on the age of the sample. So here are a list of the various useful isotopes and their half-lives. We see that uranium-238 has a half-life of about 4,468,000,000 years, and its daughter, thorium-234, halves in about 21.4 days. Rubidium-dystrontium is a commonly used pair, and it has a half-life of up around 49 billion years. Potassium-40 has a half-life of 1.28 billion years as it turns to argon-40. One of the most commonly used isotopes at the other end of the spectrum is carbon-14, which turns to nitrogen-14 with a half-life of 5,730 years. After one half-life, we have half the parent turned to daughter. After two half-lives, we are half of half, or 25%. A third half-life takes us to 12.5% of the original. A fourth halving, and we have 6.25% of the original parent population. 3.125% at five half-lives, 1.56% at six half-lives, 0.78% at seven half-lives. And then we start to have so little parent left that the mass spectrometers we use to measure these isotopes can't get a good handle on the relative amount. The amount of parent is too small for the error in the machine measurements, and we can only say it is at least as old as six or seven half-lives. Let's apply all this to a situation where we have a potassium feldspar crystal and logically want to use the potassium argon clock with a 1.28 billion year half-life to measure its age. We know that the crystal started with no argon, as argon is a noble gas which can't bond to make crystals. And if you've been taught the creationist candle that even if we know how fast a candle burns, we can't say how long if we don't know how tall the candle was to begin with, I am telling you, we know how tall the candle is to begin with when it comes to a potassium and argon system in a potassium feldspar crystal. As the potassium in the feldspar turns to argon, that gas gets trapped in the complex silicate structure, and now we can measure the relative amounts of parent and daughter and calculate how many half-lives have elapsed. The half-life, as we mentioned before, is 1.28 billion years. If you found your feldspar has 12.5% potassium-40 and 87.5% argon, then you should be able to calculate the age of this crystal. Three half-lives have passed, and each one is 1.28 billion years, so 3 times 1.28 equals 3.84 billion years, all the way back in the Archean Aeon. That would be an old mineral. We did this with rocks we brought back from the moon, and of course geologists didn't test just one isotopic clock in the moon rocks, they tested several. Now, you might have a certain amount of confidence when you have found the single clock giving the age of a sample, but how much more confidence do you have when all the clocks give the same age within the margins of error? And there is always error in the measurement, and in some cases the clocks are unusable. A geologist doesn't just pick up any rock and blindly use the methods we just described. There are certain requirements a rock or mineral must satisfy before we can trust any dates so extracted. In our next episode, we will look into these requirements and into a method of checking for the more variable aspects, isochron dating. Come spend a little more time here on Earth Explorations.